Okay.
It's so hard to see, I can't tell.
Now, undoubtedly.
Hello, Guten Tag. I'm layover in Berlin to visit center of Germany's political power, checking out lots of its popular landmarks and historical sites, including the world's most famous wall that ever came down, learning about its history by crossing the checkpoint named after me, and blending in with the young locals at the hippiest part of the city, as well tasting many of its budget-friendly food options and ending the night by chilling out like a real Berliner with a German beer at its most recognizable gate. Not to mention, getting around inexpensively with public transportation. All free, all under 16 hours. First documented in the 13th century and situated at the crossing of two important historic trade routes. Since the 1400s, Berlin had been a capital of many kingdoms, empires, and republics. Today is the capital of Germany and the seat of the federal government with a population of 6 million in its metropolitan area. It's considered a world-class city of culture, politics, media, and an economy focused on high-tech. As well, it's Germany's most populous tourist attraction with many amazing free attractions. With so much thing to see and do, let's get started. Beginning in October 2020, Berlin's Tiergarten Airport will be decommissioned, and you'll be arriving at the new Brandenburg Airport. Regardless, Germany uses the mighty euro, and if you need to withdraw some bling bling, all major banks in Germany do not have a surcharge for using their ATM, including the one at the airport. Yay! You need some cash or cards to go anywhere.
So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Berlin. We have landed, and the best way to get down for cheap is go and get a bus ticket. What you also can do is get a 48-hour ticket, and that way you can use the public transportation for a whole 2 days. With that being said, look at that. That is our bus.
X9. Good timing.
The passes is valid for 2 to 6 days from the first use and valid on all public buses and trains in Berlin, and as well discounts on many pay attractions. As most of our attractions are located in the city center, it is easily accessible on foot, or there's many bike sharing services available. But to make your layover easier, for a short stay under 10 hours, you can check your luggage to your final destination or use the luggage storage at the airport. For overnight or long layover, I suggest you stay in Berlin city center close to a metro station. And that is where my accommodation sponsor is located. The E7 Hostel is a trendy hostel that provides very comfortable private rooms for a group of all sizes, and dorm beds for budget travelers, with free lockers, 24-hour hot showers, fully equipped kitchen, great social atmosphere, and an excellent breakfast for a few euros. The best of all, only a minute away from the metro station and amazing staff. Thanks, guys. We will start our day right at the heart of Germany's political power, the seat of the Parliament of the Federal Republic of Germany. The Reichstag building is a neoclassical building designed by Paul Wohnert, and the construction started shortly after German unification in 1871. Completed in 1894 and become the seat of the German Empire between 1871 to 1918. The Weimar Republic fell from 1919 to 1933 until it caught fire under mysterious circumstances. The unused building sustained additional damages from Allied bombing during World War II, and the neglect in the post-war eras led to further deterioration. By the 1970s, it has undergone partial restorations and become a museum of German history. More extensive restoration and renovation took place under the direction of British architect Sir Norman Foster after the reunification of West and East Germany in the 1990s.
So there's two ways of seeing inside of Bundestag. First is by guided tour. You need at least 4 to 6 weeks reservation in advance. The second way is a little bit easier. If you want to see the dome, You can go across, get the tickets, but get it at least 24 hours in advance to guarantee your admissions, because the same day tickets are almost not possible. And by the way, bring your passport. The security is tight here, they won't allow you in without it.
The building's huge glass dome, once most recognizable feature, was rebuilt. The futuristic and transparent design of the Reichstag Dome has a mirror cone to direct sunlight into the building and a view of the debating chamber of Bundestag, both intended to symbolize democracy and Berlin's attempt to move away from paths of Nazism. An interior ramp spiraled to the top of the dome, offering a visitor a 360-degree view of the surrounding Berlin cityscape. After restoration was completed, the Reichstag became one of Berlin's most prominent tourist attractions, drawing hundreds of thousands of visitors each year. I hope you'll have a chance to be one of them. It's really cool.
Similar to most Western democracies, here in Germany, there's three branches of government: judicial, legislative, and executive branch. And contrary to popular perception, the office and residence of the Chancellor is not in the Bundestag, it's the building behind me at the Chancellor building.
After the German reunification in 1990, the German government moved back to Berlin from Bonn. The Chancellery was temporarily housed in the former GDR State Council building until the Federal Chancellery complex was completed in 2001. Today is both the official residence and executive office of German Chancellor, as well as the largest government headquarters in the world. Germany has an open attitude when it comes to confronting its history's dark chapter. On the south side of Reichstag and near the Brandenburg Gate, there's a permanent memorial dedicated to the memory of 220,000 to 500,000 Sinti and Roma victims of the Nazi regime. The triangular shape of the stone is in reference to the badges that had to be worn by the concentration camp prisoners.
Now, undoubtedly, this is the most famous and most recognizable landmark in all of Germany, the Brandenburg Gate. It was built on the order of the former Persian king, Frederick William II, on the site of the former city gate, marking the start of the road from Berlin to the town of Brandenburg.
The gate is located one block to the north of the Reichstag building. Shortly after the 30-year war and a century before the gate was constructed, Berlin was a small walled city within a stone fort with several gates. It gained the status as the capital of Kingdom of Prussia, facilitated the growth of the city. And the King Frederick William II of Prussia commissioned the new gate to represent peace and was originally named the Peace Gate. Throughout its existence, the gate was often witness to major historical events. Napoleon was first to use the Brandenburg Gate for his triumphant possession after 1806 Prussian defeat at the Battle of Jena Aztec. More recently, the famous 1987 speech by the US President Ronald Reagan. In his address to the people of West Berlin, he demanded the Soviet Communist Party to dismantle the wall in his support for German reunification.
Mr. Gorbachev. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Today, the wall is considered not only the symbol of tumultuous history of Europe and Germany, but also European unity and peace. A block away is home to the official office of representative of European Commission in Germany. West Germany is one of the inner six, the founding member of the European Coal and Steel Community, leading to the creation of modern-day European Union. So, if you are interested in learning more about EU institutions and functions, or getting to know about its single market, this interactive free exhibition is definitely the right place to visit. In addition, mini parliament, there is a lot of free literatures for you to take home. few steps away from the Brandenburg Gate is Tiergarten, the third largest inner city park in Germany. There's many interesting monuments and architectures. This includes a Soviet War Memorial just 700 meters away from the gate. The memorial is erected by the Soviet Union within a month after capturing the city to commemorate its war dead, particularly the 80,000 soldiers of Soviet armed forces who died during the Battle of Berlin in April and May 1945. The memorial was built from the stonework taken from the destroyed ranch Chancellery, where some of the marble used to build it come from the destroyed government building nearby. Today, the memorial is still a site of active commemoration and pilgrimage for the war veterans from the country of the former Soviet Union.
So I thought I was able to walk from the gate down to the monument, but no. I didn't realize it's such a big park. So make the most of your 48-hour pass by just taking the bus. And I think we're there soon.
Another Berlin's iconic and historic monument is located at the center of the park. Designed by Heinrich Strack and inaugurated in September 2, 1873, to initially commemorate the Prussian victory in the Danish-Prussian War.
So finally, we arrive at another important and iconic landmark here. The Berliners call this statue the Golden Lizzie because of the golden statue. But its official name is Berlin Victory Columns. It was inaugurated in 1873 to celebrate Prussian's victory in the Austro-Prussian War and the Franco-Prussian War.
Since Prussia was also victorious in Austro-Prussian War and Franco-Prussian War, these later victories in the so-called Unification War inspired the addition of bronze sculpture of Victoria. The Roman goddess of victory measures 27 feet high and weighing 35 tons, designed by Frederick Drake. Another one of the important monuments is the Berlin Wall Memorial. On September 11, 2008, the Berlin House of Representatives approved the opening of an open-air exhibition on the anniversary of the day that Berlin Wall fell. In addition to having a 60-meter section of the original wall, it also has a visitor center and a documentation center.
The Berlin Wall Memorial was created in 1998 by the government to commemorate the separation of the city by the wall and the death that occurred here.
The goal of the guarded concrete barrier was East Germany's communist authorities' goal of physically and ideologically divide Berlin from 1961 to 1989, largely to restricting immigration and brain drain of the population to the more economically developed and capitalist West Germany. During the years of the wall's existence, around 5,000 people have successfully defected to West Berlin. The East German government issued a shooting order to border guard dealing with the defectors. The number of people who died trying to cross the wall have been disputed, but it is estimated the death toll to be well above 200. Those trying to lease East Berlin were subject to heavy penalties. The installation shows how the border was set up at the end of 1980s and give a visitor the lasting impression of the construction that once divided a country. Another one of the important landmarks is just a short ride away. It's a very famous since it's named after me. Just joking. It's actually the best known Berlin Wall crossing between the East Berlin and West Berlin during the Cold War. And this crossing represents the separation of the East and the West.
Now here's another important landmark here in Berlin is the Checkpoint Charlie. Now this is the most well-known Berlin Wall crossing between East Berlin and West Berlin. During the Cold War. In fact, the tension got so high at one point, the American tanks was facing off the Soviet tanks. Now after the Cold War, this became a tourist attraction. Now if you wonder which side is American side, you just need to look at the flag and also where the KFC and McDonald's located. It's pretty easy to find.
The name Charlie comes from the letter C in the Native Phonetic alphabet and was designated as a single crossing point on foot or by car for foreigners and members of Allied forces. During its 28-year active life, the eastern side added the watchtower and zigzag barrier as well as multi-lane shed. However, the Allied authority never erected any permanent buildings since they do not consider inner Berlin sector boundary as an international border and do not treat it as such. Now, after almost a full day of burning calories, I'm hungry. If you're on a tight budget, don't worry, there's a lot of bakeries all over the city for you to grab a quick bite. They offer a large variety of local pastries for 1 or 2 euros, but I got extra few dollars to spare. I mean, extra few euros to spare. In recent years, Arab food become very popular, and the entire platter will set you back only 5 to 8 euros, and I am at one of them. But somehow, this place got more than the Arabic selections.
So in every single place I go to, I always have to try Chinese food. This place is really close to Checkpoint Charlie. It's Middle Eastern food, but somehow they got stir-fried noodles. With that being said, by the way, there's chicken in here. Let's eat and try it out.
Since we already spent the whole day discovering the old and historic Berlin, let's check out its progressive side. So out with the old and in with the new. Although there's nothing high-end, you can get high with a joint here without being judged. No joke.
So if you wonder what's the hippiest and what's the most chill place, this is probably it. This is the area near the riverside where the hippie have taken over, bought a bunch of properties, put in some pubs, and also where people can come and relax and have a drink near the riverside. And it's also a place you can come and smoke some pot. With that being said, let's look around.
The Spare Bank for All, or the Timber Market, is Berlin's largest and most sustainable urban development project. Started as a tiny shack of scrap wood on an abandoned lot at the Spree River in the mid-2000s, it became a quirky urban oasis known as Holzmarkt. Today, the whole public area has an open door policy. Anyone can come in and has many restaurants and food stalls, a daycare for kids, a wine shop, a gallery, a yoga studio, a co-working space, 2 stages for theaters, and all kind of events along with several bars. By the way, the legal drinking age is 16 in Germany. How nice. The last attraction of the night is a Berlin television tower, the tallest structure in Germany and third tallest in the European Union. Constructed between 1965 and 1969 by the government of East Germany, it was intended to be both a symbol of communist power and of the city, but is a little pricey, and I think money can be better spent elsewhere, like on German beer and wine, cheaper than bottled water.
Now, you can't come to Germany and not try their beer, because Germans are very famous for their beer, and it's very cheap too. And you can drink on the street and you're not going to get into trouble. So this is what I'm going to try. The reason I picked this one is because it looks really fancy. I'm also going to try a German wine. So this together only costs roughly about $3 or so. It is super cheap.
So, this is how I'm going to end my night and this episode by celebrating the successful and very productive layover of Berlin. I'm going to determine to do it publicly.
So I'm going to dive into the liberal culture here in Berlin. Do what Berliners do. That is to drink and enjoy authentic German beer by a beautiful landmark, and behind me, as you already know, this is Brandenburg Gate. The person who helped me open this up is actually a police officer here, so that's pretty cool. And he also taught me how to say cheers in German, and that is Puls. All right. Oh my God, this is like good beer. Good beer. Well, after enjoying my German beer in front of Brandenburg Gate, it's time to move on to the German wines, and there's no better place to enjoy it right in front of the German Parliament. So let's open this up and have a taste. And for your information, I am a little bit drunk, but I'm not crazy. Amazing. Red wine.
After enjoying my German beer and wines, it's time to head back to hostel for a good rest for my morning flight. I recommend you be on your way to the airport no less than 3 hours prior to the departure time. The cheapest and the easiest way to get to Berlin Brandenburg Airport is by taking a metro to our Rudolf station and followed by the bus line X7. With that being said, I hope you have lots of fun laying over in Berlin and wishing you a safe journey. Have a pleasant flight and thanks for watching and see you next time. Auf Wiedersehen.